Welcome to the Cousin Brew Show!
Yeah, morning!
What is up, Brother Cause?
I'm living in this world, living in this fine world where one can watch as many NBA basketball games as his young heart can take.
That we can, and we can even watch basketball players in Europe, even though we sent, this rare great point out of Charles Barkley last night was, why in the hell do we send the Knicks and the Wizards over to Europe if we want to grow the sport, if you're the NBA? And they do it with football, too. And he said, I don't even know who's, is it the Super Bowl yet, Kaz?
Super Bowl? Oh, no, it's the championship, the conference championships this week.
I figured I couldn't be that out of the loop to not know that, but I don't know the teams. But anyway, he says, like, why do we keep sending the Jacksonville Jaguars over there? And I was like, damn, that's all I know about that Europe game in the NFL is they keep sending the damn Jaguars over there.
And yeah, the Jaguars have been quite a few times. I think they – yeah, I don't know. That's a good question. It's not. I understand the Knicks because they're a brand. I mean, it's terrible basketball, but it's at least a brand that maybe people will be familiar with over there. But I mean, you could send somebody besides the Wizards. I mean, they haven't been relevant in 40 years. So,
or you could send like LeBron and Giannis and KD and the Warriors. Like,
well, I think that those teams also. The thing about the Wizards, too, is they don't get a packed house. I think that might have something to do with it as well. It's like, well, they're not going to make any money here. Like the Warriors and the Lake and LeBron, they're going to sell out everywhere they go. So maybe they want to keep that revenue, for the teams, as opposed to the Wizards who are going to have 15 people in the crowd anyway. So you might as well send them over to London.
The old short-term gain for the long-term loss. I love it. And nothing like us to just go spinning right into a topic. We actually have some great topics here on this here Cause and Brew Show. First, I'll mention our sponsor, Hawaiian Isles Kona Coffee. Thank you so much this morning. You were helping me out tremendously. We're going to talk about the Warriors, right? We're going to talk about whether or not we should all be afraid. We're going to talk about some Kyrie Irving. Really interesting stuff with Kyrie Irving. When you sent this topic over, at first I was like, because I don't even think about the Boston Celtics in fantasy coverage very much. They're just a boring, not great fantasy basketball team. And then I got to thinking about the Kyrie stuff that's popped up lately with leadership, and it's really interesting. And also Charles had a decent take on that last night. That's two for Charles.
Man, the one that I don't listen to them at all. He apparently comes with wisdom.
They were actually pretty funny last night, and they're funny on most nights.
They're funny on most nights. Funny, yes.
Funny, insightful, entertaining on most nights. Sometimes they can just not know a thing about a thing going on in the world of hoops, but they were pretty funny last night. They were showing, did you catch, this is classic, did you catch the Michael Beasley stuff last night?
No, I was watching that game a little, but I guess I wasn't watching it close enough.
Oh, dude, so this is the ultimate Michael Beasley, and we were spinning out of control in the first 3 minutes of the show. So dude went into the game wearing his practice shorts. Yep. So he busts off the warm-ups, and he's wearing these, like, black Laker shorts.
My God, Michael, no. No. Did they immediately escort him to go pee in a cup right there on the spot?
I mean,
it would have been. It's only because he's had that history, smoking weed. Like, come on. You, of all people, can't do that. Anybody else in the league can do that and everyone will chuckle it off. Michael Beasley, absolutely, under no circumstance, can do that.
He's been going through a lot on the personal side, with his mom passing and everything. Like, it's been rough for him, so I hate to bring it up, but it was still pretty funny. Like, he, as he pulled his warm-ups off, he looked down. Somebody, I think, even shouted, "Hey, your pants!" And he like had that look of like, you know, your dog like goes into the garbage, and they don't want to go to the garbage because you've told them not to go to the garbage, but they got that look of like, "Oh, I did it again!" And he looked and like, "Oh, I did it again!" And just sort of like ran to the locker room, and great fun there. But they were.
Show Luke's face? Like, what was Luke's face like when that happened?
You know, Luke's face looked a lot like the entire game. the Lakers are really interesting because there seems to be an inertia there that to try to get him out of there. And
there does, and I think it's unfortunate. I'm not a fan of it, and we'll get into it later with one of the. We'll get into that. They're one of the.
Yeah, we'll throw that in as like 2B or something. But yeah, it's just a strange, interesting time. But I'm sure Luke Walton, as he's getting just bombarded from different angles about whether or not he should be the coach, just seeing between that and the Lonzo Ball foul last night where he fouled Russell Westbrook on the ground down three. They called it on. They basically gave Westbrook three free throws, and the guy made all three, and you know that was that. Sending it to overtime.
I will say that I felt was a bad stretch of coaching that last 3 minutes from Luke, and I don't understand why. It doesn't seem like coaches are making situational defensive substitutions anymore.
He's been Yeah, he's been getting killed for that. He's been getting killed for that.
Because I just didn't know why Lonzo Ball was on the floor for stretches when they clearly could have got, you know, KCP in or something like that. But that also will tie into one of our later topics. So I don't want to give too much, but anyway.
Well, let's do this professionally, and let's get right into our topics here. We have the Warriors. They go into Denver, and they talk up the Nuggets before the game, which is a classic championship team move, is to just, oh, look at this team leading the league in the halfway point, they're so good, and look at what they're doing, oh, and let's drop a 30 burger win on you on your home floor, and let you know who we are. So
an emphatic one. I mean, for anybody that didn't watch, I mean, that thing was over at the tip.
And what they do so well, I think, is they have that playground cachet where if there's bad blood on a basketball court and playground ball and you win, the amount of flexing and the amount of like fight initiating trash talk that occurs is, you know, that's that feeling you get when there's a lot of bad blood and you win. It's like, yeah, I'm gonna let you know about it. And the Warriors let everybody know about it. They let the fans in the front row know about it. And it's, I'm sure Michael Malone probably like lost a few marbles on the way home in that one. Not that it's surprising. And I bet he probably, there's elements that he wasn't, you know, he knows they're the Warriors. I don't think he's, you know, dumb to that. But that's just like it's not emasculated, but it's like just a gut punch type of a loss that they.
It was a little bit emasculating.
A little bit.
That was a little bit emasculating.
A little bit, yeah. That's why I was going for that word. I didn't want to say it. Trying to be nice in 2019, Kaz.
And I don't know that it was... I mean, I don't think it was emasculating for him, per se, but I think that, you know, we've talked on this show quite a bit about how we think that they, in a seven-game series, that they should be able to... give them a run for their money. And, you know, they just laid down. I mean, there really was no pushback. There was no, they seemed confused. They seemed scared. Nobody really wanted to shoot it. It kind of looked like I've coached a lot of high school ball, and it just looked like a team that, a really good team that wanted to be done with their work early and came out really physical and intense. And then like, they jump on him, and then the bad team is like, I don't want to shoot it. You shoot it. I don't want to do it. You know, and it was just a really poor performance.
They have a weird balance issue on offense that gets masked by the greatness of Nikola Jokic. And what it, to me, like, if you're going to have your distributor be your center, you know, that's, to me, that screams spray the ball around, which is what Nikola Jokic does. And if you're not getting the ball in, you know, a lot of pick and roll as a guard, or you're not, you know, getting, if you're a spot up shooter, if you're not getting that off of a pick and roll, you're getting it more out of a center operating around the elbows and stuff like that, you might not get shots very consistently. And, you know, Jamal Murray last year shot about 45% from the field. He's down at 42 this year. And it's, to me, I wonder if there's a little like hidden cost of doing business the way that they're doing business. And maybe that inconsistency is what you're seeing, guys not wanting to shoot. I don't know. What I do know.
I totally agree with what you're saying. But I don't think the case that night. That seemed like a bunch of guys that weren't ready for prime time.
Well, it's completely possible. I mean, sometimes I watch Jamal Murray and I think this guy's like, you know, a version of a kind of Steph Curry like player that, you know, could have that kind of cachet with shot making. And then sometimes I'm like, I can't even see him on the floor. You know, he's just invisible to me. And they've had a lot of injury sort of turnover. So you're getting guys like Malik Beasley's playing well and also getting a ton of minutes and shots right now. You didn't think that would happen at the beginning of the year. Gary Harris has been out the last week and a half, well, really effectively like the last month. And so a lot of turnover there. Will Barton came back in that game, didn't play much. So that was a little wobbly. I don't know if I want to give the Nuggets, especially after this game. I mean, prior to this game, I probably feel pretty close to this. I don't know if I want to give them a ton of a chance against the Warriors, like anything more than like a 20-1, you know, type deal. But they did have that puncher's chance, I thought, that, you know, if the Warriors started imploding, you know, this is a team with a lot of depth that, you know, good depth, I would call it, for the playoffs, that might be able to get hot and do something, you know, unheard of. But that said, you know, they get punched in the gut at home like this without DeMarcus Cousins in the lineup. And, you know, it kind of takes that bet off the board for me. If I wanted to put a bit of money on a Denver Nuggets upset, I don't know that I see it. We'll have to talk about the Cousins thing here in a second, but, as far as the Nuggets go, what else did you think, you know, about those guys? Are they off the board for you too?
I just didn't. I felt that, you know, they had a chance to extend this series, and they still might. I mean, I'll crank it up to a bad night as well. You know, I think that, you know, I don't know that I moved so far off, like the Warriors in six, maybe in five. I just thought that for a team playing as well as them, they just were not, they could not, and the reason that I feel strongly about the Warriors is that they were absolutely petrified of the moment. You know, Jokovic, I mean, he's gotta make an impact on that game. He's gotta score. He's gotta make the Warriors run around. They just did not show up. Jamal Murray, he was aggressive at times, but not when it was necessary. You know, they just weren't ready. And, you know, maybe some of that, you know, swagger, you know, Gary Harris being out's a huge deal. Maybe some of that kind of playoff swagger comes with Isaiah Thomas if and when he returns. But they just were clearly not ready. And they, you know, most of these guys haven't been in the playoffs. This was a early season playoff game. This was the Warriors saying, you know what? They don't really think they could beat us. We are going to pound it into their head right now that they can't beat us. And so down the road, that's money in the bank for us. Anytime we go on a 10-0 run, they're going to kill us. That's what that was about. The Warriors know how to win championships. They know how to do their work early in the season when they so choose.
Yeah, they I love that win. I love when teams rise to that that next level of, you know, really understanding the mental game. Because a lot of teams could, you know, and I think the line was, I think Denver might have been favored in this game. I didn't catch it, but I think I did see something about that.
And they may have been.
I get it. Like, you don't know if the Warriors are going to care. You know, that's the you never know with the championship teams of this ilk if they're going to just not care. You know, they could go 0-3 in their first three games against a team and then, you know, start to crank it up in April or something. You just never know. But
yeah,
this game, like, this is worth like three. You know, it's worth actually more than three. It's wiping away any chance that they, you know, can do something to you in the playoffs. You know, of course, Denver is going to bounce back, especially with Michael Malone there, and they'll, you know, get Gary Harris back and make a better run at it, keep it a lot closer, you know, in the next one. But just having that, like, they knew that if they could just go out there and just crush them, that it would have extra value. So I really like that win. The Warriors side of this, you know, this question that you asked in pre-game of have the Warriors woke up, it really comes down to a lot for me of the intangibles or the, you know, the camaraderie and the chemistry of this group. Are they getting through that stuff? And I don't know that I have the answer to that. I think that it's helped that Draymond Green has been on the floor more. You know, it seems like he's getting a little healthier. It seems like, you know, hitting a couple big shots has been good for him. But just maybe the act of being on the floor so he and Kevin Durant can play together and playing basketball can smooth over all sorts of stuff. In fact, the world just needs to play a big basketball game together. Like, you can get through some serious stuff. Like, I'm sure me and you have been in a fight and then we've played basketball and then, like,
yeah,
you know, it's like, what were we fighting about? I can't even remember. We just beat those guys. This is great.
Absolutely.
So is that in play? Cause I mean, they're obviously playing better. This is probably the best that they've been, culture wise, you know, in the locker room right now. This is probably the best they've been all year. To me, that's the only measurement, right?
Yeah, and I don't know that win in itself cured their ills. You know, I think that they are champions and they know that mental game. So regardless of just personal pride took over, I think, in that game, and they just put it on them. The stretch in and of itself, you know, being that it came after that very tough Houston loss, I think that says more. Like, I don't know if they met or if they all just had, you know, come to Jesus moments or if Kerr talked about something, but I think that kind of that loss, and now you look, they've won six in a row, and they've got some, you know, they got a, I think, a, well, I guess the Clipper, they're, the Clippers coming up, tonight, and then you have you know, Lakers without LeBron, Washington, but Boston and Indiana to finish that road game, that road trip. So you know, we'll see if it was and part of it, I think, maybe, I don't know if it's because Cousins is coming back, maybe they wanted to kind of get the ship right so it's an easier transition, because of all the nonsense that had been going on, you know, is still going on to that extent. When Cousins walks through the door, that kind of seems like a recipe for disaster. So it feels like they're kind of, you know, kind of cleaning the house a little bit for the guests.
It's funny, know? How, you know, there was a lot of, not a lot, but I want to say Anthony Slater of The Athletic, who's got a real good beat on the team, and maybe even Tim Kawakami, were, I think Anthony said that straight out, but there have been the undertones that, yeah, they're getting ready for this. And it's funny how that can actually, you know, the weirdest things can bring a team together. I mean, there's probably a lot of stuff that we just never hear about that brings a team together, just stuff that happens to them on the road, you know? Oh, and that was the other funny thing about the show last night. Speaking of the road, you know, what I was thinking of is teams going out on the road, and then maybe they land in Atlanta, they go to a strip club, and everybody has a good time, and, you know, that brings them all together. But
yeah,
I was they had this this little aside during last night's show where they totally outed Kenny for going to the strip clubs. <It was crazy. laughs> And they all had this moment where it was so funny they couldn't say anything, and then like even Ernie's just like chuckling, and Kenny just had his hand or his head in his hands, like, oh, I'm so in trouble when I get home.
So like going to the clubs like now or back in the day?
I don't know. I think the implication was now, and it was
for him to be like scared about it. I mean, you know, I would think his wife knows that back in his playing career he
might have gone to a strip club or two. Bringing the team together, come on.
Do you remember that when like very early, like before the Lakers started winning championships with Kobe and Shaq, like Magic Johnson actually told that to Kobe in a meeting when they were having problems. He was like, well, one thing you need to know, the thing you should do to help get the, you know, to be a part of the team is you got to go out to the strip clubs with them.
Oh, great advice, right? Oh, hopefully the wives aren't listening to this one, but you know, it's a pretty, you know, when you go out on the road, you do that stuff. I remember when we would go on trips for, you know, baseball, basketball, whatever, you know, those trips really built a lot of, you know, camaraderie. So,
yeah, absolutely.
You know, as far as the thing with DeMarcus, getting them back into this, like, you know, snapping back into shape. Okay, we can't be such, you know, a bleep show. DeMarcus is coming. You know, like getting ready for that guy has maybe pulled them together. And, you know, now he's going to play tonight. And
oh, he is. Okay.
Yeah. And there is a lot of, you know, been a lot of think pieces, a lot of articles are what are the Warriors going to do? And to me, this is one of the most, I'm pumped for this. I want to see what happens when the immovable object meets the whatever force. You know, Stat Boy can tell me how that saying goes. Because DeMarcus was refused his whole career now, except for like his first year, to play through the post. And I just have this really hard time seeing a team go, okay, well, you got KD, Clay, Steph, you know, all sorts of perimeter ball players, you know, that they're going to let DeMarcus operate in that space.
Yeah.
But it's the NBA. You know, coaches have a really hard time telling players what to do. What would you put your money on?
I would think that at least early he's going to get down there because, one, he's going to be pretty out of shape. So I think in order to, like, tonight's going to be interesting because, you know, they've got Harrell in there. You know, he's going to be in there at times. And you know, Harrell's just going to sprint. If he sees DeMarcus Cousins coming to the game, Harrell's just going to turn into a track meet and just sprint down this.
Love that guy.
He's just going to be sprinting all over the place. So for DeMarcus is going to have to kind of, for lack of a better term, take his legs out. He's going to have to pound him a bit. I don't know how many opportunities he's going to get like today, but just going forward, he's going to have to do that. And if he wants that big contract, like on the Warriors, you're absolutely correct with all those perimeter players on the Warriors, he's just not going to look as good out there. So if this whole thing is about get DeMarcus his big contract, the best way for him to do so is to show that he's the guy that's going to get you 25 points in his sleep on the block. Now, when you sign him next year, whether he does that or not is a different story. But for him to get that contract, I think the easiest way for him to do that is to be on the block. So we'll see.
What we've also seen is the Warriors were staggering Steph and KD. And I am actually fine with that. And I'm actually fine with it pretty much any configuration the Warriors run with because they got so many good players. But they've moved him back to playing the same minutes, the two of them, I should say. And so it does appear that they're going to go with what I think I probably would want to go with is you put DeMarcus on the second unit and you change the tenor of the team when he's on the floor, but you do keep him on the block and you let him get a lot of usage in those, you know, 20 minutes that he might end up ramping up toward. And if it goes great, maybe you expand him. You know, maybe it is the super team of all super teams. But we're going to get to see. I've always waited for DeMarcus Cousins to just play to his strengths and be a Shaq 3.0, to coin a Vivek Ranadive term. He didn't come up with that, but he used the 3.0 part. Because he's that big. And there are very few players that can, I mean, credibly even come close to just like a little jump hook. I mean, just a tiny jump hook. I can't even imagine if he dislodges you, what chance do you have? You know, I'm trying to think of a defender in the league that can stop that. Maybe.
Well, that's really the issue. Like the league has gone so small that it's really, and I just, it boggles my mind when I see, you know, these guys that actually have game down there taking these long jumpers and threes when it's like, dude, like that guy's 6'11", 210, and you're shooting a three right now. Like it's just mind boggling. So maybe DeMarcus can, at least for the rest of this year, kind of lead the charge of bringing the postman back.
I hope so. Cause I mean, and you listen around the league, you talk with people that are, you know, on the basketball side, they long for the era of post play. They want post play, but a lot of these players, they just don't have it. And so it's really kind of, it's one of those chicken and the egg things where, you know, just very few players have a traditional post play. Just to kind of bring it to Sacramento here, like Marvin Bagley has pretty good post play for a rookie, but he has no right hand. But man, if he gets to his lefty jump hook, it's unstoppable. Like, it's just, he's just too tall, too long, too springy, you know. And that's, you know, like, there are a lot of guys that could just have that. You could have those 2 points, you could have that foul trouble, you could have that inside out play, you could get the defense turning their head. It's just such a treasure chest of goodness that, you know, you get a guy like, I'll pick on Mo Bamba for a second. You know, Mo Bamba, pretty athletic guy, you know, 7 feet tall, really long, you know, probably can't do that. You know, he's trying to shoot threes.
And I think it goes to even a greater problem. And as I've been watching this year, not only, it's not just that guys can't post, it's guys really don't have any diversity in their scoring. Like, if you watch, like, it's basically a step back three league. Like, that seems to be the only move, and there's only about three or four guys that are actually good at it, but it seems to be the only move that a lot of guys have. They're either shooting threes or they're freight training to the hoop, and they are kind of developing. It seems like there is a little bit more kind of floater development with guys' strong hands, but it's getting kind of, I mean, I'm getting kind of bored with it. We'll talk about it later in the show because we have a topic that's going to take care of it. But I think the analytics and the copycat nature of, you know, the NBA is doing something, so college is following and high school is following, has turned it into where guys just don't know how to score. You know, they're scoring at a high pace in the NBA right now because you can't touch them. That's what it's not that guys are so much better and creative at actually scoring, is that they cannot be touched anywhere on the floor. But
yeah, I'm very intrigued by that topic. So let's spin over to the next topic, where we got Kyrie Irving is doing Kyrie stuff, I would say. And when I first saw the Kyrie stuff hitting, I just kind of like cracked up, like just being part of teams where leadership was not great, and, you know, like seeing somebody that maybe didn't deserve it going into a leadership role and telling everybody how they needed to do things. That was my first hit, hearing some of this criticism from Kyrie Irving about the young players in Boston. And I'm not on the ground there. I don't know. You know, I've seen some Jaylen Brown stuff where, you know, he looks like he might be a bit of a handful, but I don't know. You know, I think that these young guys made it to the Eastern Conference Finals, and they, you know, feel like they deserve a seat at the table. How that's all playing out, you know, I just don't know. But I knew coming into this year that they were going to have problems with that no matter what, even if they were really, really good in the locker room. Just too many, the roster construction is such a, like, I don't know if it's a lost art or if GMs think that they should just stack their locker room full of players and let it all sort out.
Yeah, I don't know if it's a law. I don't know how good anybody. I don't know how good teams have always been at it, but it's not very. It's not good right now. Say that much.
Yeah, I mean, you look around the league. Even like, you know, I've always been a big fan of what Pat Riley's done, and Miami is such a sinkhole right now. I mean, like every player in that locker room, it seems like, just does not have it right now, and it's because they get 12 minutes a game. But so we knew that going in. That Boston had a bit of a log jam and not a good one. And so now Kyrie Irving has been calling out these young players. And so the balance of this whole thing really for me is where I start looking at trying to diagnose why are the Boston Celtics, you know, why is Brad Stevens calling a timeout 30 seconds into the game all angry? Like that's you know, maybe that's Brad Stevens like, but it seems like they're a little bit on edge. So you got Kyrie out here. We'll do a full reset here. Kyrie has said that the young guys aren't getting it done to the press. And then he followed up with an apology to LeBron James, which
I didn't hear that.
Yes.
About
so he phoned up LeBron. This was yesterday, I believe. He phoned up LeBron and apologized for being a handful when they were in Cleveland and then publicized it.
That just reeks of kind of
passive aggressive self-righteousness.
Let me show you how I've changed, because since he's called out the young guys and he knows he's wrong, he's now backtracking and going, well, the reason I could do it is because I was a young guy who was a problem. It's like, okay, dude, like, okay. This isn't even like, this is, you know, first week of psychology class. We could see what the hell you're doing here. I mean, come on. Like, it's kind of, quite frankly, I mean, this isn't really the way that I thought this topic was going to go, but quite frankly, it's just tacky. You know, it's tacky, and it's like,
well, and to be clear, and I didn't even say it, I've been a terrible host today, cause the topic was, would you max Kyrie Irving? I didn't even bring that up, but that's the topic that we're supposed to be talking about.
But like that just is so like, you think you're so smart that you can pull this kind of a stupid charade?
Well, but now look at what his path though, cause I've seen LeBron do this stuff and I've seen the media fawn over it, and you know, it's stupid. Like LeBron does like a passive aggressive Instagram post or something, you know, whatever, name your passive aggressive LeBron thing, or does something in the media or something just to like motivate his guys. And I've always thought like, that's not how you do it. Like,
yeah, but there's all, I mean, that's true. I you know, have often, you know, questioned his leadership ability as well. Like I think there's a difference between being a great player and being a leader, and then there's different types of leadership. There's the guy that just, you know, there's kind of the Kobe, I'm gonna drag you along, I'm gonna give 100% at every single second, and you should follow what I do because I do that for you. There's the guy that's gonna put his arm around you a little more, be more of your friend and mentor, you know, and be selective of when he's going to get after you. But there's this wave of players who are just really good basketball players. And I'm not saying LeBron isn't one of those. He's just chosen to do these funky things as well. But there's this wave of players that literally are just really good players. And they, and like you said about locker, about, you know, roster construction, they've constructed the locker room to where the teams actually cannot function without this one guy. So, you know, the guy will be off the floor and the team will, you know, fall down 10 to 12 points. Then the guy will come back on and the announcer's like, oh, here they are looking to their leader, you know, to make something happen. Well, he has to make something happen. There's nobody else on the team.
It's funny you mentioned that, because like, of course they went to the Eastern Conference Finals. It's like the Celtics may not be the greatest example of that because they were able to survive without Kyrie. But like, you spin it to like Phoenix, where Devin Booker has been that guy, and there's been about a year of crazy Devin Booker stuff that I think he might be finally working his way out of, just sort of watching them post-trade, post-Trevor Ariza, which was hilarious. The veteran leadership that he was supposed to provide never showed up. And but because it's like, it's that self-fulfilling prophecy thing where, like, if Devin Booker's not on the floor, they really, really suck. But when he's on the floor, he's doing all these terrible things. He's not making anybody better, but he's still... Right. You know, the only way that they're in the game. So this young guy, who, by the way, is having a really rough go of it on like social media for his dating and pregnancy habits. He's getting he's getting hit hard right now.
We'll have to talk about this off. I don't even know why I bring it up.
It's like his own personal thing, but it is all. It's like you're a public figure, and then, you know, that stuff becomes a part of the conversation, and it probably is stressing him out a little bit. But the long and the short of it is you know, he's a young guy that's getting a big responsibility. The previous management, my God, basically made him the GM of the team. And so what, now he's talking. It's funny. He was like, he yells at his teammates. Like, you know, I remember him yelling at DeAndre Ayton, and it's like, how do you yell at a guy, and then you're gonna go do something silly on the other end of the floor, you know? Right. And that's the kind of leadership. You gave like the spectrum of leadership that, you know, I think really mature teams and you know, healthy organizations that they show, but. There's this thing in the league where I'm going to tell you how to be, I'm going to tell you how to play, but then I'm going to, you know, uncork a quadruple, you know, crossover dribble fadeaway three when I shouldn't have done it, and I turn around and yell at you to play defense. It's, you know, it's incongruent, and it happens a lot now. And so back to Kyrie, I kind of feel like that's what's going on here. You know, he's not going to play defense. You know, the shots thing is, you know, I kind of just think like the players that really get it are the ones that, yeah, I can get you. I can score on you when I want, but I really want my teammates to go for 14, you know?
Right.
Like that is just gut. That's going to break you if you're the opponent when all five guys are confident.
Yeah.
And so... I don't think I would. I mean, the injury issue alone for Kyrie Irving.
The injury issue alone. Like, you want to, like, look at this is Kyrie Irving previous to this year. I had to pull this up. 51, 59, 71, 75, 53, 72, 60. He's given you 75 games once, and he's only 26 years old. Like, that alone has to give you pause. And particularly for the Boston Celtics, you're talking about Kyrie Irving is clearly not a guy that can play with other really capable players. You know, like, but funny enough, Cleveland is perfect. The take turn offense for him is perfect. That's what he's good at. You get the ball, I get the ball. You sit down, I get the ball all the time. You come back in, we'll take turns again. I'll sit down and you can go get yours. That is where he has flourished. Previous to LeBron James, they didn't even get a whiff of the playoffs when he was the man. Last year, he goes down. And they were having a nice year, don't get me wrong. But you figure a guy that's a max player goes down, and he's your only max guy. You'd think you wouldn't get all the way to the Eastern Conference Championship and should have won it. You know, so
you know how this stuff goes. You know, sometimes teams, organizations – players, they can smell things. You know, the trade winds are, you know, in the air, and they can pick up on where this is all heading. If you're the Celtics and you don't want to max this guy out, why is he making such an imprint upon the franchise? Like, that's and you start to push against it a little bit, you know, and maybe, you know, the young players are like, yeah, you could keep talking pops, but you ain't gonna be here in a couple years, and we are.
Yeah.
And that's the chemistry issue that, you know, it's basketball, man. It's all chemistry in certain respects. And so, I mean, yeah, you know, it sounds like the solution to this whole thing It sounds great, actually. Kyrie and Kevin Durant in New York take turns offense. You know, they got really a blank palette they can work with there. You know, just let these two gun, you know, for 48 minutes and surround them with, you know, good defensive players. You know, I that's the only way I think this works out for them. And I mean, Boston, you can't do this if you're Boston, right?
I wouldn't. Seeing what you got last year with, you know, Jaylen Brown, and I think as good as a scorer as Tatum is, you know, maybe it shouldn't have given Hayward the money, but Hayward's very comfortable as being a second or third option. He's very comfortable with that. So it's not, you can still get Max Gordon Hayward, you know, considering his health continues to improve. You can still get Max Gordon Hayward, him being the third option and being happy as a clam, you know? And then if you want to try and make some sort of trade, Kyrie Irving trade for another good player, you can do that. Or if you want to get assets again, you can. But I mean, just the mere fact that he doesn't seem to be the best teammate and he's never available, I don't see what the upside is. You know, the upside is if you get into the playoffs. I mean, so you would need a guy, and maybe Tatum becomes that guy who can just score on really good defense consistently. And I think they lacked that a little bit in the playoffs. But is the journey going to be worth it with this guy? Is the question.
That was my question, is do they need a star to put them over? Because you essentially remove him from the equation. You look at last year's team. You have this really tough Marcus Smart, scary Terry Rozier, 1-2 punch at point guard and you know, to backfill some of those shooting guard minutes. And then you have Jaylen Brown, you got Tatum, and you know, you would have Hayward, and you would have Horford, and you got Baines, and it's all great, right?
Right.
It really does fall on Tatum or Jaylen Brown to develop something of a go-to game, which I don't think is coming this year. Coming this year, and this is kind of a problem with this, is when you have Kyrie Irving there and they're so log-jammed, he's not able to develop this year. So on-court development, which people think so many bad things about, they don't have the slightest clue of what good on-court development is, but he's not able to flourish. He's going to have sort of like a half year here, you know, where he learns the hard way.
And it's also a part of the, like, kind of instant gratification. Everybody expects their guys, which we touched on a little bit last week, everyone expects, like, these young guys to be so good so quickly. Like Scottie Pippen didn't come into the league scoring 20 points a game.
But clarify, this is where you torched me last show on the Justin Jackson stuff.
That's a great example
of what you're saying, by the way.
He came in as a workhorse. He got on the floor. He played D. He was a smart basketball player, but you know, he was able to develop a shot. Though he, you know, developed a little post game. You gain confidence. You know, it's almost like picking the athlete with some sort of sense of offensive know-how. And I think that they have that in Jaylen Brown, but he's not going to get any better if he goes 10, 12 possessions in a row, never even touching the ball and watching two and just standing. The worst thing that he does on the offensive side is just stand in one place and shoot. Well, I mean, and that's what they're saying is your game.
You don't even have to look that far, but you can just go 30 minutes back in our conversation, look at DeMarcus Cousins and what it's done to him to have bad on-court development, you know, color his game. And with Jaylen Brown, he's like, well, I don't know when I'm supposed to shoot or when I'm going to get to shoot. So I need to be aggressive so I can make an impact. And, you know, he's not going to get into his optimal stuff. But back to the other issue is the star thing. So Tatum really has to be that guy, right? Like to be able to get a bucket in isolation against a Kawhi Leonard like defender. And, you know, be able to go toe-to-toe with the best. And so that, I guess, is the argument that, you know, somebody that would be pro-Kyrie Irving, pro-keeping and maxing Kyrie Irving. What do you say to that?
That's the argument, and it still might not be this year, but we're talking about a guy in his second year. And Tatum, like, 2 years from now, he absolutely may be that guy. He may be the guy that, you know, he might be that guy that in the last 3 minutes a game when you're up four, You just put him in the position is you got to stop this guy 11 possessions. Do it. You know, that's what we're talking. You know, he has the kind of skill. It's just, can he match it with the confidence, the, you know, athletic ability, all those things? Can he do it? But he very well might be that guy. So if you want to, and I think possibly you're taking a risk. Okay, I'm going to get rid of Kyrie, but you might already have that guy in Tatum, and you're going to be able to develop Brown the way you're supposed to. If you keep Kyrie, you have that guy, but he might not be available, and you know you're not going to develop Jaylen Brown the way he's supposed to be developed. So that's where moving Kyrie or allowing him to leave really becomes an attractive option, because you already might have that guy in place.
This sounds like a really prescient discussion that could come so they go through the playoffs and whatever happens, and that might determine a lot of which way this spins. But you might come back and listen to this episode, you know, in June and say, wow, I can't believe that this was talked about here in January. Because I feel like the writing could be on the wall that Danny Ainge might already have your positions, and they just don't know what to do about it at this point in time, and they have to sort of play it out. It'd be interesting to see if they got ahead of it at all, if they could get ahead of it at all, get something for Kyrie Irving, and really shake things up. That might be my move, but I'm a little crazy. I want to know about this. You asked me, why are there no more comeback runs in blowout games? And you had kind of alluded to it, you know, as far as like scoring ability, score, the diversity and the ability to score, the ways you can score. Was that where you were heading with that?
When we started talking, it was more just, I was thinking more of just kind of, I feel like there's a lack of professionalism, because if you have the two teams, what I see this year, like when I used to watch basketball, and I'm not talking about back in the 80s or 90s, I'm talking about a couple of years ago, a team gets up 20 points on another team, there was always a run to bring it back to 8. You know, and then they still might get blown out again because it took so much energy. It's not that the games end in blowouts. It's that when I'm watching these games, there's never a team gets up 25, gets up 30. There's never a run, it seems like, in a lot of these games to bring it to 15, to bring it to 12. And, you know, and I'm wondering, you know, why that is. And as we've been talking, it's, you know, one, I just feel like guys are just laying down. I feel like guys are absolutely just being unprofessional. We were talking about the Pistons last week, and, you know, teams that just absolutely are just thrown in the towel, you know, 10 minutes in and not even remotely trying to put up a fight.
And can I interject real quick? Because I think people will go, well, you know, they look like they're playing hard. Like, you're being too harsh, Kaz. Like, I think people might hear that stuff and think, oh, they're professional athletes. They're giving it 90% at least. I think where you see it the most is in focus, like of what kind of shots they want to take and the little things on defense.
A lot of things on defense, you know, like letting somebody get to their strong hand when you know that's all they can do.
Focus,
you know?
Which comes back to focus and desire. I mean, you want to win. You want to bring it back to 8 so bad that you continue to take away the strong hand, which requires this level of presence that these guys are not willing to give, because what is the rationale here for these players doing that?
Well, and that's where, you know, you were talking about, you know, roster construction. And it's funny, you brought up Miami as being the sinkhole and everyone's getting this little bit of time. And if you look across the country at the Clippers, they've built, you know, this team that's going to be fighting for a playoff spot, but it's full of, you know, scrappers, and they got the young kid who looks like he's a real player down the road. But they've got these, you know, professional guys. But those two teams, Miami and the Clippers, have really put themselves in the good position for if they land a star. They already have the smart, hardworking, focused kind of role player guys that you need to win championships. Like they're actually, you know, doing it the reverse of what I think most teams in sports in general do, you know, and it's not by choice necessarily, but since the hand they've been dealt is now they don't have Chris Paul, they don't have Blake Griffin. Well, okay, we'll just get a bunch of guys who really like to win and really play hard. We'll upset some teams. We'll beat all the teams we're supposed to. And then down the road, when we have that shot, we have great assets to make a trade, or we have money in free agency. And now we don't have to worry about finding our Derek Fisher or our Iguodala. We have that guy. He's in the building right now. We have it.
And it's so like it's a reverse. It's really interesting because if you're right, if Miami was to swing a deal at the trade deadline for a star somehow, maybe like a Jimmy Butler, like say they're winning now, it's probably, you know, they needed that thing to implode for Jimmy Butler to be available, I would think, you know, right. But if Miami was to get a Jimmy Butler or, you know, somehow swing a deal for a star, you're right. They absolutely have it ready for them. And maybe that's why we look at Miami and go, what are they doing? You know, like they got 11 dudes that need minutes for whatever reason. They either got a big contract that they got to see if they could get something out of it, or, you know, name the reason, and 11 guys need minutes there. None of them are happy. But the roster construction issue, it kind of like, it's funny, it goes back to Boston. It goes back to Detroit, where like if your team, like if you knew you're a player for Detroit, you knew that Blake Griffin was signed to this stupid deal. Right?
The only thing you can call it.
It's so dumb. It was dumb when it was given to him, and it was dumb when they traded for it.
Did Jimmy was like, I mean, I always say he's the greatest front office guy in the history of sports. I mean, is he that smart that he could give out that kind of money and know there's going to be a sucker? Like, that's unbelievable.
Well, it's kind of, you know, it's funny. Like, when you play in these competitive situations, like I play in these competitive fantasy leagues where everybody's five moves ahead. And we are like doing the counter to the counter to the counter to the counter to the counter. And sometimes that specific decision is so stupid. It's like, but you got to do it because everybody's so good. You got to take a chance somewhere. Maybe that's what Jerry West was thinking. Maybe that's what the Heat are doing here, knowing that they got to do it the way they got to zig when everybody's zagging. But like, if you're Detroit, whoever, name the player, and you know that this franchise has no chance whatsoever of doing anything, you know, because of that contract. Washington, John Wall, you know, like it's like that dead animal stench, you know, you're like, that's never gonna leave, you know. And so maybe there's something to, you know, we have access to a lot of information now. I mean, playing for a franchise, there should be a personal pride involved.
Sure.
And
you're getting paycheck.
But I do like what the Clippers have done, and I like what the Heat have always done. You don't build a good team by getting a bunch of draft picks and then hoping that it all works out. I mean, Philly's experiment still has flaws. It's still taking 8 years now, you know, to get to where we're at right now. I've always thought if you're like, the Kings are in my backyard, so I can really always kind of bring it back to them, and that they're like, right now they have good players, you know, and that means you can sell that to other good players and get them to come, or get stars maybe down the road to say, yeah, I don't mind being traded there, so let's make it happen.
Right.
The Clippers are building that, you know, that foundation, so when they do get a star here, which I would think Ballmer should be able to make this happen. Like, just with the front office that they've moved Doc off of the front office. Let
Great
Doc
decision.
Do his thing, yeah. You know, on the coaching sidelines. They got a good value proposition. It's something you can sell. And I think with these teams that have these dead money situations, are you going to dive? You might, you know, hurt yourself for, you know, that team. And it just it pervades everything. I also think that the diversity of scoring is a big deal. Like these 3-point attempt numbers.
Yeah. Oh my God.
It's like roulette in a way. If you're going to hit, you know, half of them, you're going to win. And if you're going to hit a quarter of them, you're going to lose by a lot. And you get a green light to shoot them, you know, you're a player. It's smart shot.
But doesn't that, it just flies in the face of competitive organized athletics. is what, and it's a huge part of why these teams can't make runs. You know, you got down. All you know is that we're gonna shoot threes. You get down because you're not hitting them. You're down 25 points. You come out in the first 4 minutes of the third quarter. You take, you know, 7 threes and 2 twos, and you hit 1 three. And now you're down 35 points.
Well, the backbreaking one is when you're 30.
It's hard to get back up.
It's you're 30% shooter, right? Or you're 35% shooter on a low volume. Not like, you know, there's a 35% shooters out there. Like, I think, you know, maybe Kyrie was hitting 36% 1 year. You know, I think like Isaiah Thomas would hit like 36%. But they're taking difficult, lots of threes. You know, they're
and the shot clocks,
right?
You know,
all that stuff. So
things like that. It's your
small slash power forward or your big man. You know, like, hell, Marvin Bagley was doing this when the Kings lost to the Hornets last night. It's like crunch time. He's like, I'm open, but it's a good shot. Well, why wouldn't I take it? And then everybody sort of slumps their shoulders. Why are we doing this? You know, we had other options. And so there you go. You know, it's I didn't notice the lack of comeback runs. That's a good eye by you. We have a little time, real quick, before we shut this down. Did you want to have a last word on your Lakers?
It's fishy. I don't like it. You know, I don't like the culture that that Magic is setting here, and he's certainly not patient enough to. Which is weird because they had an opportunity to kind of give the house, you know, to get Kawhi Leonard in the door, and they didn't do it. Instead, they put all their eggs in the LeBron basket, landed them, and then are hoping that more will follow. But so they were patient in that, but now they're impatient with what Luke is doing. And guys, I mean, they played good last night, but they're just laying down. Guys are like, Ingram lays down whenever he feels like it. They're just not giving any sort of effort, any sort of focus on the defensive end consistently. They're allowing. You know, if they're not shooting, and they have too many guys that can't shoot threes that are shooting way too many threes, you know? And Kuzma, I don't think, is a bad three-point shooter, but he's in a rut, and he's just shooting way too many, and he has some kind of diversity in scoring, and he's not doing it. But the whole thing just smells like Luke. Like, you know, at the end of the season. Or he's not LeBron's guy or whatever, but it just smells fishy. And hopefully they'll go the route of dignity and just be like, we just don't want Luke here, and not try to make up a bunch of stories about how he's not doing this and how he did, you know, how he's this and the guys aren't responding. And so he can not have a taint on him, because there's no real reason for it. I mean, you cannot watch Lonzo Ball at the end of that game just opening up like the Red Sea to let Russell Westbrook get layups. Now, luckily, he missed them. But and that was the only thing I said, that like Luke, that was a bad stretch of coaching. Like, I thought he should have been off the floor in some of those.
Yeah, he's getting nailed for that. He had Zubac out there when they were up by something. I think 8 or something, and the Thunder had no bigs on the floor, and it was all 3-point shooters. And you're expecting Zubac to defend the 3-point line. And I remember thinking when certain Laker Twitter, you know, started calling that out, I remember thinking, that's not going to look good, because there is really no reason to have Zubac trying to chase 3-point shooters on the floor in that particular situation. But that stuff could happen because you're searching as a coach. You know, maybe you're trying to get something out of Zubac because there's something going on. I've always thought that JaVale McGee and LeBron James don't see eye to eye for whatever reason, and I don't have any intel on that. I just, you know, they tried so hard to bring Tyson Chandler in, and, you know, McGee was having a great season, and now Chandler got promoted in the starting lineup, and Chandler has been okay, but you know, I mean, he's not anything close to what he was.
Well, yeah, he's not close to what he was. I think he's actually doing better than I expected him to do. And they were so desperate for another big man because Mo Wagner wasn't anywhere near coming back. And, you know, Luke didn't really like, you know, for those of us that watched Zubac's rookie year and then what Luke did to him last year, you're kind of like, what's going on? So at least now he went and grabbed that tool and is using him a little bit. And in his defense, Zubac was having a really nice offensive game last night. So I can maybe see, and maybe that's why he also didn't take ball off the floor. But these situational type of things, and no, he didn't have a lot of timeouts because of course he has to burn them early because guys just aren't trying, that kind of thing. But the whole from early in the season, the whole thing, this just reeked of, we don't want you here. You know, like, you're not, and that's fine if there's like a plethora of phenomenal coaches out there, but what are they gonna bring in Mark Jackson? I mean, what's the game plan? Oof. You know, for, you know, you have it. And don't get me, now I'm not like you in the sense, like, I think that Mark Jackson deserves another shot. You know, I think that.
Oh, I think he deserves another shot. I'm good with that.
Yeah, but get it, but like, what's your, you know, is it just to please LeBron? Is it, I mean, like, what's your deal? What are you doing? Like, why are you not?
Well, that's what this reeks of. Let's get to, I mean, we're going to get out of here, but like, that's what this is all about. Like, there are forces at play that are, you know, when you get the dreaded vote of confidence, you know, when articles start coming out about that stuff, like,
yeah,
you're almost guaranteed there's a lot of pressure on you to get out, you know? And
yeah.
So we'll see. I mean, LeBron, Team LeBron, you know, whoever they might be trying to recruit. I mean, they pick their coaches at this, at some level. And, you know, you saw it with, David Blatt was not the guy. He was gone, you know. Ty Lue, step on up. You know, win yourself a championship. We'll see how that all plays out. Hey, Kaz, good to talk with you, man. I hope it's all been well for you.
It has been well. It has been good.
Nice, nice. Well, you can follow us online at hoop-ball.com and also on Twitter. Twitter.com/KOZANDBRU show, where we have not tweeted for 731 days. And on Facebook.com, that's Kaz's purview. Facebook.com/KOZANDBRU show. Another one is in the books. Peace.
Peace, peace, peace.
You are listening to the Kaz and Brew Show.